Which is acceptable, Gururaja? In a Raghavendra Brindavana at Chennai, a person from Karnataka assumed charge of its management. His Purvashrama grandsire was an illustrious personage who had occupied the pita of Sri Raghavendra Swami. I had a long-standing acquaintance with that person, which became closer after he came to Chennai in 2008. After taking charge, he implemented several measures in the Srimad to attract devotees in large number and won the appreciation of one and all, simultaneously boosting the earnings of the Srimad. The Raghavendra Ashtakshara Koti Japa Yajna, introduced by him for a period of 1 year's observance, had the support and appreciation of the devotees, despite the bead string given to the devotees having been of poor quality, imported from China. Devotees in large number purchased the japa kit, enthused by the involvement of the Srimat itself in the conduct of the yajna, with the expectation that their problems would get solved by their participation in such divine worship on a mass scale. Schemes which would benefit a large number may be encouraged, despite the minor hitches in their implementation, if they should satisfy a majority of the populace. Therefore, when the cost of the kit was felt to be on the high side, my suggestion was sought to add something more in the bag to compensate the higher price fixed for it, in the interest of the devotees buying those. The organizer felt that my book Sri Raghavendra of 112 pages could be put in the bag and distributed to the devotees. He therefore asked me the cost thereof and I gave him the information. He quoted a low price and I kept silent, implying my disinclination. If the cost could be less, should be less, the quality of the book would suffer, as it can be printed only in paper that may not be of the acceptable standard. Like the set ideal I follow for my writings, so too I adhere to certain norms in the publication of books. So I was not agreeable to his proposition. But he did something different. Yes, he announced during the Aradhana of 2009 that a writing on Sri Raghavendra was being released on that auspicious occasion. After the release of the book, I secured a copy of it and found that the cover of it carried the description, a real story, as if the other writings were unreal. Flipping its pages, I worked out that the 96-page publication could have been constricted in 40 or 48 pages, the font used in the printing being so large. The price of the book, based on the then rates for printing, could have been fixed at rupees 25 or rupees 30, but its sale value was set at rupees 50. The original author of that work, Sri Raja S. Gururajachar, was close to me, always showering his affection on me. When I had read out to him the episode I had written on how Sri Raghavendra Guru had graced him, which was to be included in part 2 of my Sri Raghavendra Mahimai, he had conveyed his appreciation of that writer and exclaimed how I had imagined and penned so realistically even the thoughts that were passing through in his mind in such an awe-inspiring manner, embracing me with warmth in the presence of Sri C.R. Krishnaswami Rao in the triplicate mat. At that time, he laid a request to me saying, I heard your part 1 read out to me. You have written that wonderfully well. I had given my benedictory message for it. Now I have a small Kannada writing of mine that needs to be translated by you in Tamil. As the illustrious one who had preferred that request to me was the Purvashrama son of a Pitadhipati who had occupied the religious seat of Sri Raghavendra Math, I agreed to it without any hesitation. Since it was a small book, I requested its being read out to me, which was duly completed in a few hours. It was a concise writing based on Mahakavi Narayanachar's Sri Raghavendra Vijayam. After translating one page of that writing, I went through it, but left it at that stage, unable to proceed further. On his next visit to Chennai, Sri Raja, yes, Gururajacha, sent for me and asked me about the translation work. I apprised him that I could not progress beyond one page, explaining that I have a style of my own in Tamil, which with a wide circle of readership of my books, and that it may not suit the taste of my readers if I adopted a different mode of presentation in the translated version. That would be having the flavor of his genre. Further, I told him that the end product would be a kind of motley of Sri Raghavendra Vijayam and my Sri Raghavendra. Therefore, I humbly put it across to him that he could entrust the work to somebody else. Later, in 2000 AD, such a translation rendered by another person was released, and it is the same publication with some superficial changes that was released more as a reprint in 2009 AD. The reason why I have been writing at length about this matter is that what is written in the foreword of that book requires strong refutation. The life story of Sri Raghavendra, rendered by his Purvashrama sister's son, Sri Narayanachar, had comprised 16 chapters. And when the work was submitted to Guru Raghavendra for his approval and blessings, the Pitadhipati had retained 10 chapters and reportedly consigned the others to the river, for the reason that Sri Sumadva Vijaya contains only 16 chapters, and it would therefore be improper for his biological account on Sri Raghavendra Vijayam to be as long. This is the view prevalent widely, and in the foreword of the real story also, the person mentioned earlier had conveyed such perception. In my opinion, this can only be taken as one of the reasons and not the only reason for the culling of the work to just 10 chapters. I have dealt with this aspect rather elaborately in part 1 of Sri Raghavendra Mahimai, English version. Sri Raghavendra, the Saint of Mantralaya, Part 1. More explicitly, the 10 chapters of Sri Raghavendra Vijayam, now available to us, covers Sri Raghavendra's birth, upbringing, growth, his taking to sannyasa, coronation as religious head, his pilgrimage to places, and the daily routine that he used to follow at Kumbakonam. The plausible reason for his discarding the other 6 chapters is that his life story does not end there, as otherwise it would be construed that his life ended at that stage. His mysterious deeds would then have constituted the poetic element of the biography, and the Vrindavana Pravesh would in fact in that event have figured as an appendage to chapter 16. In the foreword of the publication cited earlier, it has been said that the life story of Sri Raghavendra could be viewed from 3 different perspectives. That is, his life story, his mysterious deeds, and the glory of his Vrindavana. The person concerned with that publication has opined that these are distinctive elements which cannot be integrated. Mingling Sri Raghavendra's supernatural deeds with his life story and the glory of his Vrindavana is inappropriate according to him, which is rather baffling. I wonder whether the writer had intended to convey that Sri Raghavendra's life story ends with his Vrindavana Pravesh in 1671 AD. In that case, does not the utterance of the words Sakshi Haya Syotrahi that Sri Raghavendra had caused to be heard from his Vrindavana for the sake of a heartbroken Appanacharya constitute a noteworthy occurrence in the historical chronicling pertaining to Sri Raghavendra Swami? Again, for the sake of Sri Vadindra, the 5th Pitadhipati in that monastic order, Sri Raghavendra had kept vacant the Vrindavana that had first been sculpted for his, Sri Raghavendra's Vrindavana Pravesh. Later, he had also graced him from his Vrindavana, causing it to wobble, signifying his nod in appreciation of Sri Vadindra's poetic composition that the composer had chanted in front of the Mantralaya Moola Brindavana. Are not these incidents a part of the history of the saint of Mantralaya? After entry in the Brindavana in the 17th century, Sri Raghavendra had given darshan to Sir Thomas Munro in the 19th century, clarifying his doubts, which has been recorded in the Gazette of the then government. Does not this form a component of Sri Raghavendra's history? In triplicate Chennai, a Madhva sannyasi had emerged from the back entrance of Sri Parthasarathi Swami temple and walked some distance along the TP Goyal street and disappeared from vision at a particular spot seen by Sri Venkata Raghavendrachar. And today, a Raghavendra Mrithika Brindavana stands majestically at that place, and Sri Venkata Raghavendrachar, who had then surmised the significance of that happening, was the one who installed it there. Many years later, after he had become the Pitadhipati with the holy name Sri Sujayindra Tirtha, cannot this be regarded as something significant in the life history relating to Sri Raghavendra? Readers should be in the knowledge of many more such extraordinary events, and surely Sri Raghavendra's period, by any stretch of imagination, cannot be reckoned as only from 1595 to 1671 AD, for he has been performing glorious deeds from the Krita Yuga itself, from the time he was born as Prahlada. Therefore, it can be construed that what he had accomplished during his mundane life, his glorious deeds of his earlier births, whatever he has caused, has been causing to occur for the sake of his bhaktas, and the innumerable marvelous events taking place at his Moola Mrithika Brindavanas through his extraordinary spiritual powers will constitute the composite whole in the recounting of the history of Sri Raghavendra Swami. Adverting to what he had stated further, it had been mentioned by him that when he had come to Tamil Nadu, he found that there were no proper writings to educate the laity about Sri Raghavendra, adding that even in the few publications that had come out, there were gross exaggerations that caused dismay to him, which was the reason why he was releasing that book. Sri Raghavendra, as is well known, was born, brought up and educated in Tamil Nadu, and he had also taken to sainthood in the same state. This, in fact, is the reason for the large number of writings on him being in Tamil and getting published in Tamil Nadu. Any occurrence, whether it had happened during Sri Raghavendra's mundane existence or at the present time, needs an in-depth study and analysis in a pragmatic manner. The presentation of the findings of an inquiry and dissecting it, if viewed as overplaying, such carrying to its excess is certainly a must to justify whatever has been set in writing. It has further been said by him that the credit for publishing the full life story of Sri Raghavendra Swami goes to Sri Raja S. Gururajachar, belonging to the bloodline of Guru Raghavendra. He is also said to be the one responsible for spreading knowledge about Sri Raghavendra's writings and his thoughts in this century. His Kaliyuga Kalpatru is a voluminous work serving as the reference book for those writing about the history of Sri Raghavendra in their own style. He has mentioned pointedly, as Sri Raja S. Gururajachar is a relative of his, and Sri Gururajachar's publication is in Kannada, and perhaps he could have read only that work, such opinion could have emanated from the person mentioned about. Sri Raghavendra had entered the Brindavana in 1671 AD, and the said publication had been released in 1985. Raja S. Gururajachar was the Purvashrama son of Sri Suyamindra Tirtha, who was in pontificate from 1933 to 1967 as the 20th Pitadhipati of Sri Raghavendra Math, reckoned from Sri Raghavendra. We have seen about Raja Gururajacha in the Margayankottai episode. As already indicated, I have great regard for him and value his works highly. When Kali Yuga Kalpataru was released in 1985, the first part of my Sri Raghavendra Mahimai also came out. In fact, even before my work, some books on Sri Raghavendra had already been published in Tamil. While this is the real position, it's malicious to say that the writings on Sri Raghavendra that have come out or are coming out in other languages are based on Kali Yuga Kalpataru as the source book. Sri Raja Gururajacha unfortunately is no more with us, and the Kali Yuga Kalpataru also therefore ended with only two volumes. But it does not certainly mean that the history of Sri Raghavendra also concluded with the narratives in those. The gentleman spoken about further contents while writing the history of Sri Raghavendra, many personal experiences are intertwined, mentioning that the saint of Mantralaya has graced the writer in such and such a manner, the description running to many pages and in the process giving a twist to the life story of the guru. In fact, he himself has mentioned about certain occurrences finding place in part 2 of the Kali Yuga Kalpataru, including the one in which Raja Gururajacha had accidentally been entrapped in a vault, projecting all those as the ones seen by him or having come to his knowledge otherwise. If such personal experiences had not been written about, it would not have come to light that Sri Rajnikanth is such a great devotee of Sri Raghavendra Swami. It's no exaggeration to say that it is his assertion that Sri Rairu had graced him and extended a helping hand to him on various occasions, citing those instances, that has enthused thousands of devotees to turn to the Raghavendra cult. If these personal experiences had not been written about, what could have emerged as Sri Raghavendra's life story would have encompassed only the Puranic stories about Sri Prahlada and Balhiki Raja and the life story of Sri Vyasaraja, as also the mundane life of Sri Raghavendra, concluding with his Brindavana Pravesh. Raja Gururajacha and many others have, of course, written about all these. But my way of presentation of such things is a bit different. For instance, I had personally visited the spot of the relics of the Ugrastambha from which Lord Narasimha had emerged for the sake of Prahlada before penning about that episode. So too, I had gone to Gandaki, Shalagrama and Damodar Kund to write about the importance of those places. Though such things could have been portrayed even from the slokas about them, handed down to us from time to time immemorial. If such writings are based on my personal visits to places be viewed as something excessive, it needs to be clarified that it's something that's indispensable and not an overdoing as brought out by that critic. Sri Raghavendra does not discriminate between an ordinary devotee and one belonging to his Purvashrama lineage. Pandits and the laity are alike to him. One should really have been a paragon of virtues in the earlier births to be born in that line of descent to which Sri Raghavendra belongs. And bearing that in mind, a person of that ancestry should not be deriding others, and the nobility of that bloodline should be protected and not discarded under any circumstances. That way, Sri Appannacharya, whose Sri Purnabodha Stotra and Pujaya Raghavendraya Mantra are ever resonant in the Moolamrithika Brindavanas and Dhyana Mandapas of Sri Raghavendra, did not get the spontaneous inspiration to compose those without his enjoying the merits of an earlier birth. His association with Sri Raghavendra in an earlier birth, providing him that sort of magnetic influence and power, which will find detailed narration in my writing, Punya Bhumi Bhikshalaya, that I propose to publish later. Sri Jagannath Dasa, who had a linkage with Sri Raghavendra in the Krita Yuga, and also Sri Raja Gururajachar and Sri K. Venkatesh, identified with the mudra Ananda Vittala of recent times, have composed numerous kirtanas on Sri Raghavendra. But the Dasas who had no blood relationship with Sri Raghavendra and have yet composed immeasurable kirtanas on him outnumber those with linkages with Sri Raghavendra. They have, without identity tags, composed thousands of songs on the saint of Mantralaya in various languages, which do not carry the recognition as falling under the Dasa Sahitya category. What Sri Raghavendra expects from devotees is unflinching and unalloyed bhakti towards Sri Hari, and the same kind of devotion towards him as well. And he will certainly grace anyone with that kind of adoration. He makes no distinction based on nationality, caste or creed, which is evident in the various incidents covered thus far. I do not have the space to write about my spiritual experience in Sri Raghavendra Mahimai, but I have been touching upon a few occurrences connected with Sri Raghavendra Guru in every volume, reserving a detailed account of my experiences to an autobiographical presentation to come out later. Without understanding things properly, the assailant had said, some are writing their own experiences in life. In fact, the next episode also concerns an experience of mine associated with Sri Raghavendra. I pray every day to Sri Gururaja that I should not have another such experience during my lifetime. Yes, it was such a frightening ordeal.